Okay, hello everybody. My name is Johan Johansson and I am from Sweden. I come from Sweden and I'm sitting here with Hanna Klaus and we're going to talk about ayahuasca. Hanna is an ayahuasca healer and that's what I think is so interesting to do this interview with her. And let's start. Welcome.
Hello, Johan.
So let's start to talk about you. Could you tell me about where you grew up? You come from the Netherlands.
Yes, I'm Dutch. I'm from the Netherlands. I live in Amsterdam. And I'm already 15 years on the path of the medicine of the ayahuasca.
Yeah.
And I have been studying long time in Ecuador with different shamans from the Suar tribe, and I've been several times in Brazil because I'm also a member from the Santo Daime church. It's the biggest ayahuasca church in the world, and also there I learned a lot about the work and the healing with the ayahuasca.
Yes, so you grew up and you went to school in
Holland.
In Holland, yes. In what city?
Yes. The Hague.
The Hague, okay, yeah. And what did you study? What did you study for?
I studied Dutch language and literature. I've been a teacher.
Okay.
Language teacher.
So when you graduated, you started as a teacher.
Yes.
And then when you, what made you go to Ecuador and?
I already met ayahuasca in Holland. I met it already there. Mm,
okay.
There were already groups doing ayahuasca in Amsterdam, and I became very interested in it, and then worked with them for a couple of years. And then through all the contacts, I met some shamans from Ecuador. They were in Spain. They wanted to come to Amsterdam to do some ceremonies, and they asked me to organize their ceremonies. That's how I started.
So what was it that got you interested in this? What's the special thing about it?
Well, there's many aspects. I found it one of the most profound ways of healing, integral healing, a person on a physical level, on an emotional level, on a mental level, and on a spiritual level. It was the most complete healing that I encountered in my life.
Yeah, okay. And then when you got this, and after a couple of years, you decided you wanted to go to South America or to Ecuador.
Well, I was already so close with the shamans from Ecuador that already coming to my place, they were living in my house in Amsterdam. Yeah. So it was very logical that they also invited me to come to them.
Oh, yeah.
They all the time said, yeah, and I will always come to you, but you can also come to us in Ecuador, in the rainforest, see how we work there. You can bring groups. So I started to organize groups, bring them to Ecuador.
Together with
them,
yes. And did you learn much new things in Ecuador? You learned how to brew the
ayahuasca, of course. Yes. Yes, there were also new things that I learned, yes. Yes, and there were also things that I think later, what I've personally found out when I was in Ecuador was that there was all the time fights with shamans.
Mm.
Black shamans fighting against white shamans, people dying. I find there was a lot of conflict and concurrence going on in the ayahuasca shamanism. And that I personally found, when I found it out, I found it a little bit shocking.
Shocking. Yes, because what I have read too is that I don't see anything of this black shaman at all. Everything looks very nice if you look at the internet and look at the interviews. But
what you
have seen from the inside is actually that it's, you have said 40%.
Yes, but I'm not the only one. I'm definitely not the only one. There's many books where you can read it. There's many, many serious books about ayahuasca where you can read about all the time fights between black and white shamans and killings, etc. It's definitely not my only story. The first one to discover this was Michael Harner, who already went in the 60s to the Suar tribe in Ecuador and have been interviewing black shamans in length. You can find it in his book, Natural History, etc., etc. In depth stories, interviews with black shamans.
Okay, yeah. So he went there. And
Michael Harner, yes, one of the most famous anthropologists in the world, wrote many books. And also interviewed quite a lot of black shamans in Ecuador.
Yeah. So, yeah, I can understand the reason why you are a good shaman. It's like you want to help people. Yeah. But what do you think drives the black ones? What's in it for them?
Power, greed, money.
Yeah. Yeah. But I mean, when you take ayahuasca, it's such a you have. Talked about or in your web page, you can read about people who have sold out their land where they come from to big companies, and they're really not working with the nature as ayahuasca is very famous for that you do.
Yeah, but that's all coins come to the fact of greed, money, money, money.
Yeah,
and many black shamans are paid for their work by people that, for example, if I don't like you.
Yeah.
And I want to do something to you. I go to a black shaman, I give him a photo for you, I give him $300, and then I say, okay, give this boy a sickness, or do this to this man, make him very unhappy, and then they do it. Yeah. It's a trait.
And that actually works?
It works.
But if you would do this to me, if you were paid and you do it, how would that affect me? I would get sicknesses?
Yes. Or very unhappy, or totally unlucky, or you would lose your wife or your job or whatever, yeah.
And it actually works?
Yeah, it works.
Yeah, that is really crazy. And how hard is it to do this black magic? Is it?
That I don't know. I think it takes quite an effort.
Okay.
Because it's the same thing as healing. Healing somebody also takes quite an effort. If I want to heal you, I'm really busy with it. I take a lot of energies out of you. You know, this is quite an effort and skills. Yeah. And the same thing for the black magic. They need to be trained and skilled. They need to have contact with what we call the underworld demons, whatever they work with, and they send it to you.
But if a black shaman had done this to me, can you heal this completely for me? Because, and what do you see when you heal me? Does he put lots of demons onto me?
Yeah.
That's how they do it. Yeah. And these demons make me unhappy.
Unhappy, or make that you lose your wife or your job or whatever.
That's really crazy. Yeah, that's cool. Okay.
But I mean, and that's what you also read. This is not my own story. I don't know all the names of the books that I read, but you can read that all the time. The black shamans have to help the people that are, been doing something from the black shamans. And many times the black shaman do it again, and the white shaman have to help him, and then the black shaman and white shaman also start fires, you know.
Okay. So we're going to take a little bit break
find that.
Yeah.
A very low aspect of this whole work.
The
whole thing. These people, they are working on this level. I personally would work from a much higher consciousness. I think ayahuasca is there for the divine consciousness to develop awakening, to develop oneness with God. So I find that whole level there in South America. I find it now from a very low nature.
Yeah.
Because I think ayahuasca should be used for expanding the consciousness, unity with God, divine love, forgiveness, compassion, all that things.
Yes.
Yeah.
But instead, it's used for this simple.
That these people not come any further after taking ayahuasca for so many years and having it so long in their culture. I find it quite shocking.
Yes. Okay, Hannah, I will check that the video works and that the sound comes out right.
My experience there were a little bit shocking, because there I found out for the first time about this, you know, fight between these black shamans. And
yes,
and that is true. If I think about it back myself, I found it shocking, because I came there with these ideas. Oh, ayahuasca is love and light, and we all be enlightened and this and that. And then you come there in a culture and you found out that it's like, you know, murder and killing and black magic and this and that we were like, as a group, almost not safe because black magic people were doing things to the Western people, and my Lord. And if you read books, once again, there is this blood, this is in my laptop, ayahuasca is in my blood. That's
okay.
A book where it also describes the whole story about a fight between a black and a white shaman. Ayahuasca in my blood. There's many stories about this. Also the other book.
But why are they fighting? Is that they are jealous of each other?
Yeah.
They want each other customers? They want to be the best?
Yeah. Yeah. They're jealous. For example, that these people I worked with, Hilario and Miguel, they bring a lot of Westerners, they get a lot of money out of that, and the other shamans, of course, they have no people, they have nothing, so they are jealous, and it's all the time about money, jealousy, women, you know, that kind of things. Very, very, let's say, basic instinct things, what we should hope that we could overcome through the ayahuasca, and that is something that I don't see in that culture. I'm very sorry, but I don't see it.
So they haven't risen to a higher level,
but
they should have, you mean? Like, when they have this great tool.
It is possible with ayahuasca to really overcome a lot of things and to work on compassion, forgiveness, forgiving your enemy, blah, blah. It's all possible, because that is what ayahuasca has taught me. But I don't see it there in their culture. What I want to state clearly here in this interview is that ayahuasca is just a tool.
Yeah.
It's a combination of plants, but it can be used in many different ways. Black shamans use ayahuasca. They do very black, dark, negative things with it.
Yes.
White shamans use ayahuasca. They do really great healing things with it. Total idiots use ayahuasca and they do complete idiot things with it. Ayahuasca is just a tool, and the one that makes it work as a really healing instrument, as a healing tool, that is the shaman, that is the person who guides the ceremony.
Yes, and in what way do you do this? Because I was in a ceremony too with you, but the thing is, what I think you said is, it's important when you prepare the ayahuasca.
That's where it all starts.
Yes.
It all starts already with preparing the ayahuasca.
Yep.
So if I prepare the ayahuasca, I use the raw plants, the raw material. They go in a big pans, water. And at the moment I start cooking it, I'm already starting to blow tobacco smoke over it. And that is divine energy, that's healing energy. I really blow divine energy over the plants, the divine energy from God, from the divine energy from the Mother Goddess, divine energy from the Archangel Michael with who I work, the divine energy from the Archangel Raphael, all that angels, that spiritual energies that work with me in the ceremony, they already go over the ayahuasca at the moment I start to brew it. And I also sing their songs, because I have hymns, songs from this Archangel Michael, from the Archangel Raphael, from the Mother Goddess. They all have songs. It's are the songs from the Santa Diamond Church in my case.
Yes.
And I sing that songs all the time in that brew. And of course, you know that water is a substance that take on energy,
Okay, yes, okay.
That's very known, that is proven, I don't know, by all this, I don't know what, but what is his name, Emoto, have done all this scientific test that water takes take on energy. So if you have water and you say love, and or put the word love on it, then the crystals, when you crystallize it, it becomes very, very beautiful. But if you put on hate, It is a very negative structure.
Okay,
yeah?
Yes.
So water take on the energy. So that's because the plants are cooking in the water and it take already on all the divine energies that I work with in the ceremony are already in the ayahuasca.
Yes, okay. And then you put, because you have three different plants.
I work with three different plants, yeah.
Yes, and one of them is the leaves, the DMT leaves. And the two others, they're also the ones that make the body don't break down the DMT.
Yeah, so I work with the fine, the Manosopscapi, which is the main ayahuasca ingredient. Yes. And to make it a little bit less stronger, because in Europe it's difficult to get more, to get plenty of fine.
Yes.
It's not so easy, we don't live in a rainforest. So there is not so much fine to get to make all this ayahuasca brew. And then I use the harmala as well, the pagan harmala, the Syrian rue, to give it a little bit extra boost, so that the harmaline is strong enough to release the DMT.
Yes. Yeah. Yes.
And works totally perfect.
Okay. Yeah. And you put them when you do the brew, you do them in Holland.
Yes, I'm brewing it in Holland. Yes, in my garden. Yes.
And you store it in three separate bottles.
Yes.
Yes. So in the ceremony, then, you first you gave us this
the harmaline.
Yes.
Yes.
And you then we waited for about 20 minutes.
Yes.
And then we got the mixture of the ayahuasca
and the Jurema. Yeah.
Yes.
Jurema is the DMT plant. Yeah.
And it's also important what you do when you give us this. You sing a little bit or you do a little bit prayer before this. Yeah. And that is because you want the attention of the archangels, I guess.
From the whole divine. I mean, we are doing a divine healing ceremony. So then, of course, the first thing you have to do is to call in all these divine energies, so that they know we are going to do a ceremony for these people. We have to be there.
Yes.
And we have to give our attention and our healing work there. That's normal. That's in every ceremony. You call in the spirits before the ceremony, and when you close, you thank all the spirits, all the energies. You close them, and then they can go somewhere else or do something else.
So when I take this ayahuasca, what happens with me then as a subject? What happens with my brain? Does it get like connected?
Yeah.
Yeah, okay. Yeah.
I think, I'm quite sure that the DMT opens channels to the crown chakra. You have to hold your head. DMT opens these channels to the divine, world, to the world, the invisible world. Let's say the invisible world, the astral world. And if you have already a very pure heart and you're a very pure being, then you connect of course immediately with the high divine worlds. But most of the people have loads of problems and have never done something like did before, so they do not connect with the highest divine. Mm-hmm. Many times they connect with lower realms or lower entities.
Yes, yeah. Okay. Yeah.
And they can work on that. I mean, for many people, the first two sessions are not the best.
Yes.
Because they are confronted with their own inner struggles, pain, suffering, repressed traumas, whatever. Many people go through a difficult time. The first times they take ayahuasca. But after a while, that all cleans out, they become clean. And then the third time or the fourth time, in my ceremonies, then what I see with people, then suddenly, boom, they say, oh, Anna, now I understand what you mean when you say there is the light and we are connected with the light. Now I start to understand it. Yeah.
Yes, yes. Oh, that's really great. Yeah. So, and what happens if, for example, I have had a traumatic experience in my childhood, for example, and what happens, what's making it better when I connect with ayahuasca? Do I have the power to look at it?
Yes.
And to deal with it?
Yes. But that also depends, of course, the quality of the shaman you are doing it with.
Yeah.
For example, I am specialized in trauma healing.
Yes.
They have given to me divine tools so that traumas can be released out of the subconsciousness, and that negative energies that are connected with that trauma, that I can take that out of the chakras of the people. And that is one of my, most important work what I do.
Yes.
So the human body have 11 chakras.
Yes.
And in the chakras can be all kinds of negative thought forms, negative entities, negative elementals that sit there.
Yes.
And that influence people in a very negative way.
Yes.
And that is possible because the chakras have been punctured because of a trauma.
So the chakra cannot protect itself anymore?
Because when there is a severe trauma, the chakras cannot protect themselves. They get some, let's say, holes or punctures.
Yes.
That's one reason. Another reason is excessive alcohol and drug use or abuse that also punctures the chakras and make holes in the chakras. And many times it's a combination of things. People have severe trauma. They start smoking heavily. They start drinking heavily, or they start taking drugs heavily, whatever. So everywhere the chakras puncture, and more negative energies, we call it entities, that are beings from another astral plane,
yes,
negative ones, enter in the chakras and influence you in a negative way. And
yes,
I take that out. I take that entities out of people.
Could you tell us about some examples about people have been bad that you really have seen that, this person really...
I've seen there so many examples from. I mean, I personally estimate that 75% of the people have these negative entities in their chakras.
Of all people?
Yes.
75%?
Yeah. Because that's what I see in my ceremonies, and that's what I see in my healings. And yeah, not everybody has it that worse. I mean, there are people that only have 5, for example, and one on the heart chakra, and one here, and maybe 2 there. And other people, they maybe have 100.
Yes, yes.
And I, of course, get the severe cases because I get many times people that are severely abused as a child, sexually, physically, emotionally, on all kind of ways. You know, I get severely abused people.
Yes.
And they have loads of these entities. Loads.
Yes.
And all these people are unhappy till the point of committing suicide.
Yes.
Totally in fear, they actually not have a life.
Yeah, they are just under pain all the time.
Oh, exactly. And by removing, taking out these elementals, these negative energies, the chakras become pure again. I clean them all. And yeah, then most of the time it goes much better. I mean, I have so much examples from that people,
yes.
For example, with anxiety disorders, I've treated quite some people that have anxiety disorders, like always in fear and fear and anxiety. And after the treatment, I can do it in 2 treatments, and they were fine.
That's incredible. Yeah.
And not only with anxiety, but also other serious traumas. That many people say, after this healing, my life has completely changed.
But is there traumas that you cannot heal? Because all the traumas, if you say they are only mental, they're not physical. Like, if all the traumas, it's mental, of course. That's in your head. The experience you have gotten.
It's
not physical in your body.
Can be like traces of the trauma are also stored in the cells of the body. In fact, the trauma itself is stored in the subconsciousness, so it's not only mental. If it was only mental, it was very easy to heal, because there's a lot of techniques like NLP and other, you know, from this psychotherapy things, that they work only on the mental, like changing, you know, the attitude or changing the, and it doesn't work.
Yeah, because you have to remove them.
You have to remove the entities, and it's more than a mental thing, it's in the subconsciousness. And by removing the entities, when the chakras are clean, then there is coming this gift from the Divine Mother Goddess with who I work and who incorporate in my body, and I also blow tobacco over people. And then they take out the heaviness of the trauma. It's somehow taken out, like washed away or something out of the subconsciousness. And that's a divine gift. I cannot 100% tell how that works, but it works.
So you said this before in the interview, Hannah, but you take out the trauma from the subconsciousness, and then you lift it up so the person can deal with it, or you work with it. Work
it's the other way around.
Okay.
I first clean all the chakras from these entities. That
yes.
is the first thing.
First,
that
you get rid of all the entities. Yes.
That's the first thing that has to be done. So as long as that is what I've learned from in all this healing, as long as negative entities, negative elementals are on that trauma, it cannot heal. Because they are sucking the energy, the negative energy from that trauma, so it cannot heal. The entities first, and that's why it always takes a lot of work in my ceremony. The biggest work is always removing all the entities out of the chakras. Once they are removed, then the layers of the Mother Goddess close the chakras, close the wounds. I would say if the trauma was still an open wound, but then there's coming a layer of light on it so that the trauma can just heal.
Yes. You said that you have never seen other healers remove these entities, you said. But that's really interesting that you are the only one that removes them.
Now, yeah, in the way that I'm doing this, like removing 70 entities from a person, sometimes I have to do it in two sessions. I do 40 in one session, 40 in another session, because it's too strengthening on me also. Because, these negative entities, you have to see them as a sort of energy parasite, but they are negative, they are dark, and they also try to attack me.
Yes.
I don't want to go that far to call it a complete demon, but it's from a demonic realm. It's not from a realm of light. It's sucking negative energy from a person. It's like clinging on somebody and sucking his negative energy, like an energy parasite.
So when you are healing a person, it's of course very important to remove the entities first. And that's what I'm so surprised about when we talked about other healers, that they don't do this.
I have been with the ayahuasca shamans that I worked with, I have never seen anybody doing that in this way.
Yes.
But for God's sake, because I was thinking I'm the only one in the world knowing about these things, but that's not true. Because I finally found the pranic healing from India, which is also a healing technique to clean all the chakras. Yes. And they work with the same principles as I work. Exactly the same. They cleanse the chakras with violet white pranic light from negative thought forms, negative entities, negative energies, and they is the first healing method what I've personally found who recognize this existence from this energy parasites, energy elementals, etc. And even I have a book here, for example, I can maybe show it. It's one of their books. This is called Psychic Self-Defense. But there they also give, for example, drawings how that look, how people look that have this energy parasite. I mean, now if I start working with
some... show it to me and I will put an image in the... Okay.
Because now I can at least I have a book and I can show to my clients, you have this. So this is like people that have energy parasites from smoking. This is from heavy alcohol use.
Yeah,
this is from drug abuse. You can, or you can maybe later put it in, or we can copy this maybe.
Yeah, I copy this later. Yeah.
And that I find, you know, very interesting, and it's been very helpful for me, and also a confirmation that what I'm doing is right and existing, you know, and it works. And but I have not seen it so much from the ayahuasca culture. This is coming from India. pranic healing,
yes.
Very, very complete way of healing a person with prana.
In pranic healing, you can heal a person without ayahuasca, in fact, then.
In fact, well, in fact it does, yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, but I'm not 100% sure, because I have not so much experience with the pranic healing, I'm just learning and studying
yes.
it. If the very, very heavy cases of trauma, what I have had in my practice, if you can also heal them, maybe.
Mm.
But with the ayahuasca, it goes quicker.
Yes.
Because in the ayahuasca, I can do it in one or two sessions, and I think with pranic healing, you need maybe 10 sessions or whatever, you know. So pranic
yes.
healing, I think it works, but it takes more time. With ayahuasca, it goes very, very quick.
Why does it go quicker with ayahuasca? Is it because you take ayahuasca or because the subject?
Both.
So we get more open
yes,
to this.
That's the thing. That's the thing. The chakras, the energy system goes open through the ayahuasca. And then when the healer is qualified, and I have to say I'm qualified because it's the Archangel Michael working through me. Eh? In fact, he is the one taking it out of all the chakras of the people who work through my hands. And then it goes very quick, of course. It's a very, very fast way of healing.
Yes, yeah. Okay. We also talked about danger, about that it's dangerous for people. Could you talk a little bit about people that do ayahuasca themselves and,
yeah.
and why it's yeah. dangerous?
Okay, as I already have said, ayahuasca is just a tool and it only can work accordingly to the divine plan if it's really done by a good shaman or healer who knows what he's doing.
Yeah.
Okay. Now, then there are people, to start with the worst case, that have never done, you know, I've seen a couple of YouTube films about ayahuasca, and then they think, oh, I'm going to do this, and they order ayahuasca through the internet, that's possible,
okay.
Then they start cooking it themselves, but of course they don't know that you have to bless it, and that you have to pray, and that you have to sing, and most of the time they don't even have spirit helpers or guides, or very strongly.
Yeah.
Okay, so then people just brew that ayahuasca already, maybe negative energies come in, because negative energies are always there everywhere in all the realms, so maybe already in the brew, you don't know. Okay, then they start drinking this ayahuasca. Now, maybe the first time they have good experience, second time maybe they also have a good experience. Yeah, and then third time something goes wrong, like a very strong negative entity comes in, enter them. And I have, you know, seen these people asking for my help. I mean, I'm not, you know, inventing
yes.
this, but I get emails from people that say, yeah, I have done a couple of times ayahuasca by myself. I'm now possessed by a demon that attacks me every day. I don't know how to get rid of this anymore.
Yes.
Now, in a way, I can help that person. But most of the time, it's somebody that live in the United States, or they live in, I don't know where, Sweden, or they in Italy. And I say, yeah, okay, I mean, I can help you, but you have to come to Amsterdam, and yeah, they don't have money, and they don't have this.
Yes. And you also break down mentally when you get this, you don't have the power to go to you?
That's another thing.
Yes. Yeah.
The one that recently wrote me, he said, yeah, since I have that demon, I'm so severely attacked, I cannot work anymore, I lost my job, I have no money, blah, blah, blah. I don't know how
yes.
to get to you.
Yeah.
Now, that's one thing that people do it by themselves, but I've seen it more. I've even treated people that did a couple of times ayahuasca by themselves, and they were full of entities. Full.
Okay.
Because it was not protected. Yeah. The space was not protected. They not even knew that they had to protect themselves. They did nothing, they think, oh, I just drink, and what happens is that your energy system go open and you're not protected by any guidance, and then these negative entities which are everywhere can enter you, and they did.
Yeah.
I had this summer somebody that I had to treat. He did 2 times ayahuasca himself, but I've been a full day busy.
To removing
yeah.
the entities. Yeah. Oh, that's incredible. Yeah. Yeah.
Now, that's in a sort of same way happens also when people drink ayahuasca with somebody who is not a well-trained shaman, because then the same problem happens. You understand? There's also people that have been 6 weeks to Ecuador. They did some ayahuasca there with shamans.
And they believe and they say, know
oh
how it
yeah,
works.
I can do it. You know, it's no problem. I start groups. You know, it's because it's of course like for many people a nice way of making a living and they make their ayahuasca themselves. They probably know something about spirits. It's possible they will have some more knowledge, of course. But even then, if you're not very full trained to see what's going on in the ceremony, then there can also be a lot of problems like opening the energy system, negative entities going around, maybe even demons going around, and nobody sees anything. You know, everybody says, oh, it was a great ceremony, and you know, and then you go home with, I don't know, 25 entities.
Could you explain what a demon is? It's entities, they are small entities that. But a demon is more a complete.
Yes, it's a bigger being. But you have, like you have so many spiritual beings, like benevolent ones, good ones, and also bad ones. There's a whole range of, in the world of darkness, there's a whole range from, let's say, these negative energy parasites who are also already dangerous for people. And then you have bigger demons, and you have this dim size, and you have even, you know, lords of darkness. I mean, there's a whole range of things.
Yes, okay. Yeah. And this, what we talked about earlier, when a black magic healer attacks a person, he uses one of these, does he? And then why do you need a picture? You have to have a picture to what is it in the picture that makes it work? Is it the picture has a connection to the real person?
Of course. Of course, totally. They read the whole energy system from the picture. And within it's the same with the picture, you can also do healings. I can do distant healings through a picture for my parents, for example. And that's what I many times do. You can do distance healing, and you can also do the other side. You can also do a lot of damage.
Yes. And you said the pictures are the best thing, really, to do this.
No, yeah, they it's are not very helpful.
But in the good way, to make the connection, the picture is good. So you said also that it's bad if they get pictures of you.
Yeah.
Then they can use them to attack.
Yes, and nowadays that is almost unavoidable with
Facebook.
Exactly. So that is how the black shamans that have attacked me got my pictures, got to Facebook.
Yes. So how do you, because you have been attacked, how do you, they come to you in your dreams?
Yeah. You suddenly get something, you get ill, or you know something happened with you,
How do you know it's a demon?
That is something that the ayahuasca show you. When when I took this ayahuasca and I found out that I was very ill. Then the ayahuasca show you this is a demon and sent by these ones. That is all what ayahuasca showing you, and in the meantime trying to help me to get rid of it by vomiting loads and loads and loads and loads and loads.
Yes. The ayahuasca is that you use ayahuasca to heal, but you can also use it if you are not affected by some bad demons. So what can you do then? Then ayahuasca can help you to a higher plane, a higher understanding.
Exactly. I would say that most of the people when they first take ayahuasca are a little bit clouded, a little bit covered with negativity, because that is unfortunately the world where we live in. Very dark, I would say. So it takes a little while, but if you are once overcome that and out of that and have been vomiting and have healed your stuff, then the world of the divine can open for you and you can really expand your consciousness. You can come into contact with divine beings. You can start seeing a lot of things what are in like you know, expanded consciousness, understand what's going on here and what is my place here in this in this whole world, and why is the situation as it is?
Yes.
And why is it such a mess?
Yeah. And you have an idea of why it's such a mess?
Yes.
And it because our world is filled with these entities, you mean?
That's one thing.
Yes.
Our world is filled indeed with entities that are bothering people, but I'm very sure that they are sent there purposely to keep people in a state of misery, pain, conflict, war, negative energy. I'm very, very sure this is not a coincidence that we have these negative energies everywhere. Nay, this is a bombardment coming out of the worlds of the darkness. Who wants to control this planet? And they can control us through pain, suffering, poverty, conflicts, religious conflicts, the whole bloody story, it's all purposely done.
Because it's lots of, if you study the politics and the rulers of the world, then you see it's lots of Satanism in the top. And that is how they control us, or are they controlled by this?
That works very much together, yeah. I think the top of the elite in this world is definitely dark and doing
is
Satanism.
This only the Western
government?
The whole world?
Yeah, the whole world.
Okay, yeah, okay.
The whole world is now ruled by this, let's say. You know, there's everywhere they have their secret societies and their things to control the masses.
Yes.
But yeah, I think that they themselves are also controlled by a higher dark power that is not from this world, but in another, you know, from another plane. You know, it's layer upon layer upon layer.
Yeah. And if maybe you could give us an idea of how this could work for them, like if you're amongst these families that are ruling the world. What do they do? And you have treated people that have been victims of Satanism and stuff, and these rituals. What do they do, and why do they do it? What is the purpose to do with a child, for example, do satanistic rituals with this child?
Now the thing with the children, why they do it is to get their life force. The life force from a child is very high. And these beings, they need all the time life force. The biggest thing, what it's all about, I would say, is about energy. Because the world of the darkness don't receive the light of God. Because they have taken their back to the light of God. Yeah? Yes. So they are not supported by the light of God. And normally, every living thing in the universe needs the light of God to live. So this world of darkness is not receiving the light of God anymore and need an other energy source.
Okay.
And that energy source are we.
Yes, okay.
Understand? So it's a battle about energy. If they could not live on us, they would die.
So that keeps... What about the film Matrix? Have you seen it?
Yes.
Then we humans are batteries? Do you think it could be like that?
Yes.
So, yeah, why would it work on animals?
Animals, same.
The same?
Yeah.
But maybe they're not as powerful as we are? Or maybe they don't have that
much? But on the other hand, you know, and there's also so many animals suffering here on this planet from all kind of maltreatment. Every form of negative energy that is generated is a food source for these creatures. Mm. So we are, you know, I find it really horrible to say, but in fact we are nothing more than just a food source for the evil and the darkness. And that is the bad news.
Yes.
That's the very, very bad news, that we are just a food source for evil and darkness.
Yes.
But you can if your consciousness become high enough, totally one with God, then it cannot touch you anymore.
Yes, because there are many people like you, and probably me too, that they don't feed off that well.
Then they cannot feed off you anymore. If your consciousness is raised very high, but then you have to be consciously to be one with God and really, you know, telling yourself that every day and praying, and also I bless myself with tobacco and do it every day. I'm one with God, I'm one with His love, I'm one with His protection. Nothing happens to me. Yeah. And they can also not use me. And I'm also warned by my angels for, you know, things that I have to be done, or, you know, things that are going to happen, or, you know, I'm really guided so that my life is going this way.
So it also protects you in your physical world?
Yeah.
Yeah. Could you be hurt in your physical world?
It could be, because the work I'm doing
is
not very much appreciated by the evil and the darkness, to say it.
Of course not. Yeah.
To say it, at least, I would say. Yeah. I mean, if they have a chance, they would get rid of me. They would kill me or give me an accident or whatever, you know, the evil and the darkness. And then there's, of course, still the people in Ecuador also, that still the black shamans are still also trying to get me out of it. But that all comes together, you understand? I have already a big fight with black shamans in Ecuador, and there's coming the rest of the evil and the darkness. Yeah. They don't want me. They don't want me to tell this. They don't want me to make known that these entities exist, because this is what they all want to hide.
Yes, of course. Yes.
They don't want anybody to tell, and for God's sake, in this book, it's also, I'm not the only idiot that says, but they don't want people to know that there is a load of entities invading in the people, in the energy system, eating their energy, because that's what they're doing. They feed on their negative energy, and they keep them also in the negative energy. And that's how this whole cycle keeps going on.
Yes.
You understand?
Yes, I understand. And
but it is possible, and I want to state this very clearly, everybody that really wants this to get out of this. There is a way out of this prison.
Yeah.
And a conscious way out. First, get rid of your entities, if it's or the whatever, or the panic healing, whatever, get rid of all your entities, and then really do meditation, higher spiritual goals, that you become one with the light of God, and then it's finished.
Yes, so we, the people, could actually win.
Yeah.
Or do you think that it looks very dark for us?
It looks very dark because the indoctrination from the evil and dark is very, 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 very deep.
Yes.
So there are, for God's sake, quite a lot of people who start to understand all this more and more and more, and open to this and really want to change, but I don't know if it's enough. Because in the mass media, what they do to manipulate, you know, brainwash the mind of young people.
Yes, I notice that every day.
You know, this what you see, like the pop stars, the movies. It's all about satanic rituals.
Yes.
Suicides. While everything is black, and it's all like pumping, you know, this kind of messages in the brains of the young people, and they are very vulnerable for that. Yeah. Secondly, they are busy with this, you know, economical crisis and bringing crisis everywhere. So everybody is like, you know, concerned about his money.
Or everybody should have fear.
His how do you say, survival.
Yeah.
So that is the way that they control us in this moment very, very, very deeply.
Yes. But why do you think that the families that rule this world, why do you think do they want to do this, or do they feel forced to do it? Are they also forced to do it? Are they obsessed by maybe stronger demons that control them totally?
That's possible. That I don't know. I think it goes indeed really from high level to high level like that. That's true. It's
yes.
But if with these people that are doing this already for so long, and in these families that are also like genetically manipulated, they have some of them are not even real human, they half human, half reptilian.
Yes.
So they're not total humans. So then it's very easy, if you have no emotional body or whatever, then it's very easy to do satanic rituals and kill babies and I don't know what I'll do,
yes.
And kill everybody who's in the
other. Because we don't have any emotional.
They have no feeling for that.
Yeah. Okay. We'll take a short break.